Good morning, all our participants. Thank you very much for joining this session. Speaking on behalf of the Institute and Goretti is my name. I would like to welcome everybody who is already logged in. I see a number of people from the industry. Of course, our hosts are very well represented. I can see a number of trainers from the Institute that are online. So you're all very welcome. And we will start right away. This is our third webinar. And we are glad and delighted that it is touching a subject that is important to the industry and to us as an institute. So we'd like to thank everybody who's found it useful to be online, because it demonstrates your commitment to professional development, something that the industry really needs. This time to start us off is going to be the chairman of the Institute's Board Committee on Education and Membership, and that is none other than Mr. Michael Mugavi, the MP of Housing Finance Bank. Michael, thank you very much, and we trust that you're representing the entire board. So Michael, allow me hand over to you so you can do the welcome remarks.
Thank you very much, Goretti. And thank you, colleagues. Thank you, members of the fraternity that have tuned in to our webinar this morning or this afternoon. Good afternoon to you, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to begin by thanking you for tuning into this webinar that is focusing on a very critical subject in today's global banking world. I'd like to appreciate the management of the Institute of Banking and Financial Services, chaired and championed by the CEO, Goretti, for taking deliberate steps in making this happen under the strict adherence of social distancing rules and SOPs. Needless to emphasize that the precarious times we live in of COVID-19, the pandemic that has completely disrupted the way we work, the way we operate, and I believe this is the way to go with webinars and e-learning programs. So thank you very much, Goretti and your team, for doing a splendid job and for getting this underway. I believe many institutions and other like-minded CEOs and bodies should do like you're doing. The importance of professionalism in the banking industry cannot be overemphasized. Indeed, industry captains the world over develop critical skills that lead them to steer the organizations to greater heights through training. That's how they develop the critical skills. And colleagues, training is key in developing and emphasizing and enhancing these critical skills and competencies. So the Institute is championing this. And again, I believe those that of you that have tuned in to listen to these experts will greatly benefit and find a lot of value. In an industry that demands of everyone the ability to learn and learn and relearn, e-learning programs come in handy for most of us as bankers who are faced with enormous volumes of assignments, moreover with constrained time frames. So we need to do this more often. We need to immerse ourselves in the various e-learning programs. And I can tell you the Institute has quite a lot for us on the plate and more to still take in. Indeed, history attests the fact that most of the frauds, incidents that occur, in part, these occur due to inadequate oversight over key control measures in the bank. In a rapidly evolving risk landscape, bankers need to update their approaches to risk management across key functions of the bank. Embracing key e-learning will therefore go a long way in addressing knowledge and competence deficiencies in Uganda's industry today, banking industry today. And we need to do it together. We need a concerted effort of both the participants and the partakers of this knowledge. We need to all gather together so that we're able to leverage this for better banking going forward. In this webinar, my colleague, Bwana Kalifung, will expound on the evolving nature of the professionalism and the industry challenges, further pointing out the stability of e-learning under the current operating environment. I'm also excited to see two key industry professionals Ms. Doreen Tobijira and Mr. Peter Kalangwa warming up to discuss their own professional experiences with the e-learning in Uganda's evolving environment. I believe we'll all benefit from the great knowledge and insights that we'll share, that will be shared this afternoon. I thank you all for tuning in and I wish you fruitful deliberations. Thank you very much, Goretti. Thank you very much, panelists and the keynote speaker. And thank you all of you that have tuned in to participate in this webinar program this afternoon. I thank you very much and over to you. I'd like us to dedicate more time to the learning, to the insights. Mine were brief opening remarks, and I want to assure you that we'll be doing more of this. We'll leave no stone unturned to ensure that we develop professionalism, bankers that are worth the profession, and I believe we'll achieve that together with the Institute and the industry as a whole. Thank you very much. Over to you, Goretti.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Michael, for those opening remarks. I think they've really warmed us up to the main subject matter. Friends, as you have noted, today we are delighted to have a totally different arrangement where we're having a moderator who is also part of the industry. And I'm delighted to introduce her today. First, to say that she's a fellow, an honorary fellow of the Institute. We have had the calls for fellows to be more involved in the Institute, and she happens to be our pioneer in this regard. Rita is a member of the Association of Certified Chartered Accountants on top of her fellowship at the Institute. She holds a master's in economic policy and planning of Makerere University and is a certified trainer at the Institute of Corporate Governance of Uganda, ICGU. She's also, her banking career spans to 30 years across several banks in different countries in Africa, arising from banking officer to executive director level. She's currently working privately in consulting, in governance and risk management, as well as compliance. Rita has served as a director on a number of boards, playing key roles in the strategic direction of the business of the respective organizations. She's a member of the network panel for ACCA Uganda and a member of the board audit committee of ICGU, as well as a member of the board of the Rotary Club of Kisugu, Victoria View. I must note that Rita became an honorary fellow at the Institute in recognition of her contribution to the banking sector in Uganda, and she continues to do that. And so now I will end here and hand over to our moderator, Rita. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Goretti, for those very kind remarks and words of introduction. I'm excited to be here because the Institute is dear to my heart, having been on the board at some point in during my career. But today I'm here to moderate on a very key topic. And like Mr. Mugabe has said, in the financial services sector, we can't avoid training. Training is the key to all the things we do because of the involvement and the changes that happen in the industry. And of course, COVID came. So what do? We had a lot of plans. So here we are with e-learning, and we are trying to see how can it be a gateway to professionalization and the human capital development within our industry. So we have got key speakers today that are going to share, like has already been highlighted, and I'll just like to introduce them and give us a feel of who they are in terms of their experience and their profiles before we go into real business. Our keynote speaker will be Mr. Momba Kalifungwa, who is actually the CEO of Absa Bank Uganda. And this is a role he has held since April 2020. So welcome to Uganda, Mumba, because you're new here, you came in the hot seat, and we are already baptizing you by fire. So prior to this, he was an executive finance director at Barclays Bank of Botswana for 5 years and held a similar role at Barclays Bank Zambia until 2015. He is a chartered accountant by training, with a wealth of experience with both private and public sector, 24 years, but 15 of these are in the financial services sector. His experience cuts across several areas in banking, but he is passionate about achieving results and growing talented leaders through his collaborative leadership style. He holds a master's degree in business administration from Heriot Watt University and is a fellow of several accountant bodies, including the UK, Zambia, and Botswana. He also has substantive experience on serving on various board committees, some of which have included the board of directors of Barclays Botswana, Barclays Zambia. He's a member of the Africa Region of Association of International Certified Professional Accountants, based in South Africa, and is a board member of the African Regional Board of Chartered Institute of Management Accountants, to mention but a few. That is going to be our keynote speaker today. To support the keynote presentation, we're going to have two panelists, and one of whom comes from the big bank, the Blue Blood Bank, Ms. Doreen Chowjira, who is currently the head of learning and development for Stanbic Bank, a position she has held for the last 2 months since July 2020. But prior to this, she was the senior human capital business partner for personal and business banking business at Stanbic Bank. She has been critical to the transformation of the Stanbic business and culture over the last 5 years. She's a certified coach and has a passion for development and enabling individuals and teams to achieve their full potential. She is also a certified in the area of organizational design, project, and change management. Prior to working with Stanbic, she worked with People Performance Group. And Doreen has a passion for human capital development, as well as enabling individuals and teams to achieve their full potential. We have from another angle, Mr. Peter Kalangwa, who is a finance and investment banking professional with over 10 years of experience across various facets of East African financial services sector, including financial institutions and regulatory bodies. Currently, he heads the strategy function at Housing Finance Bank and is a trainer with the Uganda Institute of Banking and Financial Services. And I must say, he is both a trainer but was a trainee at the Institute before actually embarking on this. He too is a fellow of the Institute of Bankers, so adding again more value to the industry. He has worked with several commercial banks in Uganda to establish inclusive solutions to the unbanked majority. He has also worked with the Central Bank of Uganda, Kampala. Peter holds a certificate in development research and economic modeling from Applied Development Research Solutions, USA, and a master's in economics from Makerere University. He's also a chartered certified banker and a chartered certified accountant for the UK. He also holds certificates in financial services from the Chartered Institute of Securities and Investment of the UK and financial modeling from Euromoney Lending Solutions of the UK. He is a leadership graduate of Johannesburg School of Finance, the International Development Institute Ireland, and the Kenya Institute of Insurance, College of Insurance. He also serves on the Governing Council for the Association of Uganda Retirement Benefits and Pension Schemes. Please join me to welcome our key speakers today and look forward to an exciting time. I think we are all but definitely interested in our own personal development. So let's listen in. Let's hear what we have to say. And I would like to also request kindly that you keep your phones and videos muted while we are having the presentations to avoid the echo. And also, if you have any questions as the presentations go along, there's a Q&A section on your tabs. Kindly put those questions there and we will pick them up at the end of the presentations. Welcome, Mumba. Welcome, Doreen. Welcome, Peter. And please, I hand over now to Mr. Mumba Kalifungwa.
Thank you very much, Madam Moderator, Rita. And thank you very much to the Institute for according me and the other colleagues an opportunity to share some thoughts around the role of e-learning in promoting professionalism and driving human resource capacity building within the banking sector. So this afternoon, I think what I will try and do is pick up from where Mr. Mugabe had spoken around my thoughts in terms of what professionalism is, how e-learning can be used as an intervention in terms of driving professionalism within the banking sector. I will also try and share some thoughts in terms of some of the learnings that I've picked up in terms of some of the challenges that e-learning does present, some of the opportunities, and also the future outlook in terms of what e-learning or what place e-learning will play in our lives going forward. So with that brief introduction, I would like to approach the conversation as follows. First of all, I'd like to start by propounding on the term professionalism and what it means or entails. So the term professionalism essentially speaks to the conduct that aims or qualifies or characterizes a mark of a profession or a professional person. That is key. So in the context of banking, when a person refers to a banking professional, it is referring to an individual that has required certain skills that are relevant to the serving or the provision of banking services, as it were. And in speaking to this professionalism, there are certain characteristics that I do believe are quite relevant or are necessary for every banking professional to uphold or at least adhere to. First of all, it is around specialized knowledge. What do we mean by specialized knowledge? Specialized knowledge relates to individuals having specialist traits in terms of know-how, in terms of skills and capabilities in relation to the areas that they operate in. This is a key attribute of any banking professional that that works in the financial services industry. Competency is another attribute. A person who espouses to be or claims to be a professional needs to be competent in the deliberation of their mandate. And this is a key element in terms of professionalism. Honesty and integrity. Working for a bank requires high levels of honesty and integrity, because obviously we deal with financial resources for which we have a fiduciary duty to oversee and exercise due care in terms of how we manage them. Confidentiality, I think another key element of the attributes that a banker needs to uphold or to have. Having the desire or the respect for client information, information relating to the company or to the bank, is a key attribute that bankers need to uphold. Accountability, I think, is another attribute that one cannot overemphasize. Every professional that engages in the discharge of, the duty of being a banker needs to be ensure that they uphold accountability in the discharge of their duties. The next slide speaks to the role that bankers play in society. Ideally, what we're trying to depict here is to say banks, as we all know, act as intermediaries between depositors and borrowers. To this end, bankers have a fiduciary duty of care to the depositors whose funds they are entrusted to look after. As a consequence, bankers and banks are required to act in the interest of the public and the regulated institutions to this end. Because the fact that we more or less play an agency role where we are using depositors' funds for the purposes of providing safe custody to those funds, investing those funds, and enabling growth of borrowers as a contributor to developing the economy. So professionalism is something that is a very important attribute in terms of how we discharge or operate as bankers. In the context of the financial services sector, what is the key learning that is important? I think training is not an option. Training is something that is a key attribute for bankers. Given the evolution of the world, there is a term that has been doing the rounds in terms of describing what the effects of COVID-19 have been, or a single description to what COVID-19 can be attributable to or described as. And it's been described as a black swan event. As a consequence, the reason that it's described as such is because no one would have foreseen this eventuality, the impact that COVID-19 has had, not only on economies, healthcare, ways of doing business, is something that no one would have anticipated. So even E-learning, as a consequence, has become one of the ways in which we change the way we do things, the way we do business, the way we look at knowledge acquisition and in imparting of coaching abilities. So training, as I say, is not an option. It is something that we need to continuously invest in as bankers, as institutions, as a way of continuously building capacity and skills of the individuals that work for these banks, so that individuals are equipped to respond to the challenges that arise in the environment as it changes. Teaching employees to work with new technology under training, I think, is a key element of the things that we need to emphasize or focus on going forward. And training, obviously, is beneficial to the customers that we serve, because as the employees that work for banks invest in acquiring new skills and embracing new technology in terms of ways of doing things, the consequence or the effect of that is that the client's experience is improved as the employees that are serving them are being equipped with new trends. Compliance is another critical aspect in the banking sector. So compliance training, I think, is one of the most important interventions which borders on the conduct of individuals who work for banks. So it is an area that requires for us as bankers to continuously renew our knowledge and update our understanding and learnings relating to trends in terms of compliance activities, which will definitely lead to us preventing breaches in laws and regulations and also protecting customer confidentiality. It has become a lot more complicated and costly to adhere to regulatory requirements and the need to comply with various laws and regulations, given the challenges that the industry faces, cannot be overemphasized. I think this slide is meant to speak to the key skills required in the banking industry. I'll speak to some of the to a few of them. Number one, I think credit analytics is a key skill. Risk management is a key skill within the banking sector. Cybersecurity and financial crime management, which I alluded to, as part of the need to continue to enhance the training of people who are vested with the banking responsibility. Soft skills and relationship management, all these are aspects that are critical and relevant to the banking industry as we strive to grow the industry and improve the experience of customers from the service point of view, and also in terms of our fiduciary responsibility of having accountability over the custody of the resources that have been entrusted for us to administer over. Next slide, please. Some of the challenges and emerging trends in learning, I've listed a few there. There's an aspect of insufficient investment in training. There are skills gaps that arise in terms of computer skills, data analytics, soft skills as a response to what is happening in the environment. Digital transformation, I think, is a key buzzword or key experience that we are undergoing in the sector and across the sector from an economic perspective, a geography perspective, and across the globe and the continent. New ways of working, new ways of learning and engaging employees. The conversation we're having today is a demonstration of that, those changes and embracing those new ways of working and new ways of learning and just generally new ways of interacting at a business and a professional level. Rapidly changing technology trends in terms of artificial intelligence, such as blockchain and the like, are all elements that are happening in the environment around us and provide us with a challenge in terms of how do we respond to all these challenges to ensure that we continuously invest in building the capacity of our employees or various leaders that work within in the industry. Proposed responses. As we look at the challenges that are presented with respect to learning, some of the things that we can consider are the delivery methods. The event that we're having this morning, this webinar that speaks to professionalism and capacity building in the financial services industry, is a true testament or example of how we need to evolve in terms of how we deliver some of these trainings, how we have some of these business meetings and conversations. So virtual or e-learning, I think, is a key delivery method that can be considered. Virtual coaching, from a training and development point of view, it is relevant for individuals to undergo coaching from time to time as part of their development and as part of a response to the changing environment. So virtual coaching is an element that can be explored as an option to respond to the challenges that arise from a learning perspective. Earlier on, I think my colleague Coretti from the Institute spoke about what can we do to encourage people to learn and not just rely, say, on institutions to organize formal training for them. There's a concept we refer to as self-learning. And self-learning really speaks to individuals taking ownership for their personal development. They should be in the space where they define or identify their personal development gaps, either individually or through learnings from your line manager or your leadership coach, and embark on interventions that will help or enable you as an individual to build skills that close the gap that you may have identified from your learning or from your day-to-day activities. So self-learning is one of the key responses that one can embark on as a way of responding to the challenges that have been posed about the new way in which we should be learning and new ways in which we should be picking up in terms of fostering personal development and skills development at a personal level. Some of the key focus areas or considerations when it comes to e-learning is managing and communicating remotely. I think, as in the case of a number of you, the first few months of the year when we had to start adopting these new ways of working and learning, we needed to acclimatize to the new ways. So the way we acclimatize is by being clear in terms of communication, being clear in the way we manage the process of e-learning, and formalizing the process and adopting it as a new way in which, delivery of new skills and knowledge can be undertaken. I think self-leadership, as I spoke to earlier, is about owning the leadership training yourself as an individual, leading yourself into developing new skills and capabilities that speak to the key industry requirements. As I indicated earlier, issues of financial crime, cyber risk management, credit risk management, and overall enterprise risk management. Cybersecurity is something that we need to be alive to as we embark on these e-learning programs, and also from a learner perspective and a service provider perspective, it is key that we take these considerations of cybersecurity into mind by ensuring that the platforms or environments that we operate under are secure and ensure there is no compromise of data, or there is no data compromise or information compromise. Some of the advantages of e-learning from my perspective is that you can manage e-learning at your own pace. You will not necessarily, depending on the delivery model, rely on the tutor that is delivering that particular training. Self-paced training speaks to you managing your space, leading to increased student satisfaction and reduced stress, because you will be able to manage the e-learning within the confines or comfort of your home or office and in line with your own personal schedule. From a cost perspective, I think one of the benefits that has arisen or can be derived from e-learning is around simplified logistics and lowered travel costs. Because of the mode of delivery, you can deliver e-learning from one point to a large geographical location, which is not limited to borders, but cuts across borders. You can manage the learning environment. You have total control on where you want to learn from, and you can customize this to the best of your abilities. E-learning fully utilizes analytics, which is one of the things or developments that we're beginning to see. This can help institutions improve their training materials and boost learning outcomes. And from an analytics point of view, you can be able to derive from systems, learning systems, the number of people that have completed, for example, certain mandatory courses that are required for you to operate in the financial services sector. You can pull up reports that speak to the capability gaps, that speak to the interventions or the progress that has been made in interventions or in learning certain skills that are required in the discharge of banking professionals. I think in terms of scalability, as I spoke to the self-paced benefit in terms of learning, the scalability in terms of the geographical location, the training concepts that you can disseminate over a large geography without people having to travel to one location. Because pre-COVID times, for certain international players or international banks such as ourselves, one of the norms that was there was where you travel and gather to have these, say quarterly or annual meetings in one geographical location. Yes, there are benefits to doing that in terms of the networks and the personal touch to certain discussions and learnings. But what e-learning has showed us is that, yes, you can carry out and conduct most of these meetings online and get the desired benefits. I think the only downside of that is you miss out on the human interaction. But next slide, please. In the next slide, I think I was just sharing some thoughts in terms of some of the challenges in e-learning and some proposed responses. Some of the challenges that are encountered or can be encountered with e-learning, number one would be a lack of a learner's motivation. Earlier, as I spoke to some of the approaches or attributes of e-learning, I didn't mention the fact that the need for individuals to own their learning agenda or learning journey is quite critical. So sometimes when people are subjected to e-learning and not in the confines of a formal, say, boardroom or classroom, the motivation of an individual to conduct certain training can be impacted negatively. Busy schedules of learners as bankers, I think the stress and demands of the roles that we undertake is something that that is quite commonplace in all institutions as a consequence of the pressures of certainly the volume of work and the sort of the nature of the work that we undertake to service our clients. There is an assumption that everybody is tech savvy when it comes to e-learning, but what this has prompted us all to do is to take the interest in developing an interest to learn the new skills, learning how to use new applications. I think before the advent of COVID, when it came to e-conferences and e-conversations, some of the common platforms were things like Zoom. Zoom wasn't really, there were the platforms such as Skype. Zoom was there, but I think the amount of usage or the level of usage wasn't as emphasized. Microsoft Teams is another e-platform that has developed during this COVID pandemic. So, there is an expectation overall that we should all be tech savvy in order to, be able to navigate these platforms. But again, that is a myth, because once you've had one experience or two, you do realize that it does actually make the working easier if you just make the effort and take the interest to understand how the platform works. Beliefs that e-learning offers no support, that's another myth that is being demystified. Learners can't see the real-world implications of the e-learning course, and I think that speaks to the human interaction that is normally associated with these learning activities. Unreliable internet connectivity, I think, is a challenge across the continent and across the globe. Sometimes you'll find internet connectivity is impacted due sometimes to bad weather, sometimes there are faulty switches and the like. So these are some of the challenges I think that are presented through this new way of learning. High cost of accessing equipment. I think equipment such as access to internet, access to equipment such as laptops, computers, and Android phones is not something that is easily accessible by all individuals. So sometimes may provide a challenge to e-learning. On the positive side, in terms of responding to some of the challenges presented, speaking to a few of them, I think the need for learners to be self-motivated is quite critical. The aspect of time management skills are crucial for online classes. Online learning relies heavily on technology. We just have to face it. There's no two ways about it. It is upon us, and it is up to us to embrace it as a tool or an avenue through which we can deliver training. And I do expect that beyond this point, which the Institute, I do believe, has already started, the Uganda Institute of Bankers should be considering programs that are responding to the key critical skills that the banking industry thrives off or thirsts off, and provide programs that are relevant to address those skills gaps that may have been noted. Online programs requiring virtual communication. There is an opportunity for ourselves as leaders in the industry, and also as the Institute, to provide these online classes where there is interactive discussions between students and the service deliverers or the lecturers that provide these particular learning interventions. Online students can also team up with a virtual learning community in order to address that aspect of human intervention or the personal touch in terms of face-to-face or real-time responses and brainstorming activities that may be required as part of the learning activities. I think the aspect of improving internet access, speed, and coverage, this is a broad discussion. And from a banking sector perspective, I would imagine that most banks have invested in the right communication channels from a wide area network perspective and a connectivity perspective to improve on the speeds in order to not only support training needs, but to support their overall platforms that they use in the provision of banking services. I think the subsidies for costs of e-learning and equipment is a potential response that can be considered by key stakeholders that are involved in the determination of the pricing of aspects, say from a tax perspective, a policy perspective, and the like. Colleagues and the distinguished listeners, as I conclude on the case for e-learning, you will agree with me, as I indicated earlier, that COVID-19 has seen 2020 as a black swan event that was not anticipated by anyone or predicted to happen in the year 2020. It has taught us that volatility, uncertainty, and disruption can happen at any time without notice. It has also propelled the use of technology in various spheres of life, such as trade, healthcare, and education that we are speaking to this morning as a sector. The rise of e-learning as a vehicle to human capital development is something that we have to embrace in full and cannot overemphasize as something that has come to stay. As I come to the end of my presentation, I'd like to leave you with a quote on learning. Frank Herbert, an esteemed author of fictional science, said, "The beginning of knowledge is the discovery of something we don't understand." In conclusion, I'd like to submit that e-learning is an imperative to improving skills and building capacity in the banking sector that should be fully embraced as part of the way we grow professionalism in the sector now and in the future. I thank you so much for your attention, and we'll be happy to hand back to the moderator. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kalifunga, for that very, very eloquent and well-presented keynote. You've really excited us. I'm excited. I'm hoping everybody else is as excited as I am. And I have a few discussions that I'd like to draw yourself and the panelists to before we get the audience to also ask their questions. And I'll start with Doreen. And Doreen, you have one of the largest employees number in the financial services sector. And I just wanted to hear from you, when this happened, of course, we had our plans and everything, and now we are being, we are impacted by COVID, the black swan, like we have been presented with. What have been the opportunities that you have seen? I know a lot has also been given in the keynote, but now we, from a Stanbic perspective, as the largest employer in the financial services sector, what are the opportunities you have seen? And of course, on that, on the other side, the challenges in terms of embracing when COVID happened, in terms of your learning platform. If you could share with us your experience in that aspect.
Okay, thank you, Rita, and thank you, Mr. Kalifunga. I think that kind of helps to set the context. In terms of opportunities, for the longest time, we have been talking about the digital journey, digital transformation, and a lot of the time we focus more on the customer client experience. True to our purpose, in Stanbic, Uganda is our home, we drive our growth. What we've been trying to do as well is to say, how do we make dreams possible for our employees? So when COVID hit, it was actually an opportunity to kickstart or accelerate the work that we had already started. So we had already started the journey around e-learning. In terms of what has shifted since, what we have been able to see is a deliberateness around what people are learning. Of course, when we did start on this journey, a lot of the learning was the regulatory courses, you know, the mandatory courses as bankers, we know those have to happen. But then we started to see a shift into future skills. So if you think about digital skills, data analytics, critical thinking. So people started to explore a lot of that. The other opportunity that I see for us is e-learning allows for access across the organization. So given, if I think about Stanbic, we are spread out across the entire country. So every time that, you know, the logistics involved in transporting people to a centralized training ground, those are no longer an issue. So from a cost perspective, and for people who, for most people, I'm sure you can recognize this, a lot of our learning costs are linked to the logistics, right? Transport, accommodation, and the like. So that's no longer an issue. So it allows us to now use those resources to make sure everyone has access. So what we've been able to do is grant access to every single person within Stanbic Bank to all the learning platforms. They've been able to get access onto the learning apps. We have been able to provide data to the different teams because we recognize now that people are going to be learning from home. The other opportunity is then we're able to, you know, look at trends to say when are people actually learning? And a lot of the learning would happen over the weekends, but also you find that most people are doing some learnings maybe early in the morning or late in the night. So e-learning actually provides that. Before, you couldn't do that. If I had to have a training and it has to be done physically, there's certain limitations in terms of when I do it. So that has been a real, real opportunity. The other opportunity that I'm seeing is we've removed the barriers. Previously, you'd learn, but you're learning about a specific program. But with e-learning, if I am the head of learning, but I am thinking at some point I'd like to be a chief executive, for instance, guess what? I'm able now to say, for me to be a chief executive, what do I have to know? What do I have to be learning? And I can start to learn that now, you know? So I think the barriers have been dissolved in terms of what people are learning. People now have a lot of access to a lot of material and content. So they are able to self-serve, choose what they want to learn, and then just think about how they can apply all of that. There's been a behavior shift as well in terms of opportunities. So COVID has been in some ways a blessing in disguise. So we started to think about how do we accelerate this? How do we create some excitement and build momentum within the teams? So we have done learning hours or learning moments. So every team on a weekly basis has either learning hour or learning moment. And what we've been trying to do is focus that learning as well. Because there's a lot of content. It's easy for people to kind of be all over the place. But as an organization, we also have a purpose. So we're saying we want to consistently deliver meaningfully to our clients. What are our clients looking for? You know, if we talk about the digital transformation journey, what does that actually mean in terms of what our people are learning and how they're applying that? So these learning hours or learning moments that we're using are really encouraging team learning. Sometimes people are cautious and tentative individually. But when we've done the team learning moments, people are sharing what they're learning and they're picking up on specific topics, you know, and then they're able to share those with the team. And if each person has an opportunity to present, share their learnings and takeaways, eventually what you've done is you've allowed for each person to go learn something and share with the team. But as a result, individually, they get really curious, you know, and then start to get into the learning platforms and figure out which other content they can consume. So the other opportunities that we have been able to identify is, how do we make the learning more palatable, but also more focused? So the content is a lot, I'm telling you. There's so much that is happening. But then it also became imperative that we focus our people, but also make it lighter. So COVID and also the agenda that we're driving now around e-learning has got us as the human capital team of the learning professionals to say, what's our delivery mode? So, and maybe that also speaks into some of the challenges. One of the challenges that we had and we've been now working on was the old way of thinking about learning, and we just kind of copy and paste into e-learning. And this is what I mean by that. So if I have been running a program, let's say branch manager development program, a certain way where people come into the classroom, in terms of how I deliver that, the content is, you know, based on the fact that I'm going to be interacting with people, see their faces, with their body language and text, that type of thing. So what's been happening in some instances is then people just carry the same material, right, exactly as is, and then load it onto the learning platform. So this, it was quickly clear that that will not work. So this has allowed us an opportunity to review, curate our content, use short videos, just checking and see how are people learning. People are using on their phones, on YouTube channels, they're doing all kinds of things, they keep sharing videos. So videos have become such a popular way of learning. So how do we use short videos to speak to some of the things that are happening? So that for me has really been a great, great opportunity. And it's also been an opportunity. The opportunity that's also come through is people are now sharing more. So the learning communities that are happening virtually are amazing. So when you think about things people do around, I want to do an attachment because I need to learn about something that happens in a different team. E-learning allows us to do all of that, but virtually. So it's allowing people to break those silos and reach out to different people in the different teams. Hence creating a certain level of collaboration and universality within the organization. In terms of challenges, we do have our challenges. Some I've already spoken to, but when you think about time, and Mr. Kalifunga also spoke to this in terms of our challenges, bankers are busy. People always have so many things that they're doing. The jobs can be very demanding. So you find that even with the amazing content, so what we have been trying to do there is curate that content, make sure it's not too heavy, make use of videos, so have material that if it's one learning pathway, I can break that up into not more than 30 minutes of learning. That way, I can do 30 minutes while I get home or I've just gotten home, do something else, try again tomorrow. So you find that that has also helped. But that was one of the challenges. The other challenge is, of course, authenticity of material. So depending on the different platforms you are using to learn, it's important to check the authenticity of that material as well. So we have been able, from an organization perspective, we've partnered with renowned universities. So we're doing some work with Emeritus, we've done some work, we've partnered with Degreed, and this is content that's been authentified. So it's good content, it's up to date, it's future focused. So that becomes really critical as well. In terms of application of learning, so learning is exciting and it's really fun. On the other hand, we don't want people to learn for the sake of learning. Okay, we want people to learn so that behavior can shift. We want people to learn so they start to solve for certain things and improve productivity. So with virtual learning, I think there has been that risk where people just go learn, pick up on all these certifications and then walk away. So what we are doing as a bank is focusing people. We're making sure that we include the line managers into the different interventions. We're doing mentoring. So you're done with a program, there's going to be a follow-up project. You'll have a mentor to check on what you're doing. We're using peer coaching or mentorship as well to just allow people to apply the learning and shift or create the shifts that they need within their teams. Previously, we have had challenges around execution of the learning of the personal development plans, yeah, which we call PDPs sometimes. And we've had comments like, oh, I did not execute on my personal development plan because no one in learning wrote back to me. So that is still a challenge in certain areas, but also an opportunity. Because of e-learning, you're allowed access to self-learning. So no one needs permission from anyone to execute on the development interventions that they've put in their personal development plans. So that has really provided opportunities for people to say, okay, these are the things that I need to learn. I'm just going to go get them started, you know, and the support has been provided. So, so I think broadly, Rita, for me, that's what I'd like to share in terms of our opportunities and challenges. But I see more opportunities than challenges, if I'm being honest. And I'm starting to see a more proactive team in terms of owning your learning, which ultimately is starting to translate into ability to own their careers and not just leave that to the CEO or to the department head or the line manager. I think people are now starting to see the possibilities. And that right there is the job to be done in terms of empowering our people to be able to own those careers.
Thank you so much, Doreen. You've really presented a positive picture, and that's exactly what we're trying to promote this time. So thank you, Stanbic, and that's very good. And I would also like to recognize we've got a few supporters on the team. Just to say we have representatives from other banks. We've got Mr. George Chom, a council member of the Institute from DFCU Bank. We've got Mrs. Harriet Musoke, who's head of HR DFCU. We've got Ms. Jen Aike, former executive director of the Institute and trainer. We've got Sam Tulume, former CEO and formerly NC Bank. Shafi Nambobi is the CEO of Yugaford and Microfinance, MDI. We've got Solomon Yombo, Chief Manager, Human Capital, Centenary Bank, and trainer at the Institute. Sylvia Maloney, HR, head of HR at ABSA. And we've also got the Managing Director of Bank of Baroda, Raj Kumar Mira. So thank you very much for honoring this one. And I'd like to remind the participants, if you have any questions, put it in the Q&A tab. It will be easier for us to pick it up. When it goes in the chat, it's a bit difficult to pick it up. We'll get it at an opportune moment. Thank you so much, Doreen. And now we move to another angle of the speakers. And we'll look at Peter. Peter Kalangwa is a trainer at the Institute and also was a trainee. I just wanted to hear from him. When the bang happened, what was the impact? What was the effect? How did you shift? And just to share with you, because we've now shared the experience from the head of learning and development from the financial sector, but for you as a trainer at the Institute, what was the effect? How did you go about this one? And what did you feel when this all happened and you had to change all of a sudden from a physical face-to-face training to e-learning? And what has been the response from your students?
Thank you, moderator. Thank you, Rita, for your kind words of introduction. I want to share my story in a few slides here, and I hope you can see them, Rita.
Yes, I can see them.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Mine is a story. I've been through training here at the Institute itself, and I've also been given an opportunity to train for a few years. I've interacted with my course participants face-to-face and also interacted with them online since June this year. So I'll share briefs about my experience from the trainer's perspective, but also from the student's perspective. What we used to have here were the three modes of learning, one in class, then self-study where you take your books, and then distance learning where we interact with you wherever you are as a student. So trainers would move to Mbale, to Arua, to Mbarara to be able to meet with students and interact. So this is what used to happen, face-to-face would do these interactions and people would be able to raise questions and the trainer would be able to respond in real time directly as it is there. But how do we make it to such a class? This is Kampala as we see today. The buildings there should be familiar. You should be familiar with Post Office, Bank of Uganda. That's the heart of Kampala, Kampala Road. I probably have a few students and trainers in there stuck in jam. For a couple of hours, probably going to attend a lecture, also taking 2 hours or even less. So there's a bit of time lost as you try to move to the training room or training venue. But not everybody would be seated in a car like that. Some people would move like this. This is also familiar. It's a familiar sight for most of us, trainers and students making it to class. Maybe you've dropped your car somewhere, you just have to make it to class because you don't have to miss this particular lecture. And for the distance learners, this is also very familiar. Global coaches, Elgon Flyers, my colleagues who use Gaga, and then my other trainer, Mr. Fumbi, the day he was actually due to fly out to Kigali, he was stopped at the airport and was told that lectures are no more in Kigali, have been suspended. So that was the experience that we used to encounter. And people would travel in the evening for weekend courses here at the Institute. The bankers, as Mr. Kalifungwa had stated, they have quite a busy schedule. And also the same alluded to by Mr. Michael Mugabe, they have a busy schedule. And so as they work through the week, the only time available for learning is on the weekend. So we have people who would move in from Bali, from Gulu overnight, and then they will come here for a Saturday morning class, ready to go back on a Sunday afternoon for the next week's job. So these are the kind of ways we use to interact with most of our students. Things have changed a little bit, and this is still on air. This is what we appear like nowadays. We see students able to connect with us online. Some are seated in their offices and we're able to connect with them. Some are actually at home and they are able to just set up a home office or a home study room and they are able to tune in, and then we are in position to discuss the subject that is at hand over the e-learning platforms that we are running at the Institute. So what are we seeing now? We're seeing a lot more flexibility in terms of ability to stay where you are and then be able to connect. We're seeing a lot more time savings in terms of how much are you spending on the road to just make it to a lecture. I remember there are many days that I would make it to a lecture for 2 hours, but then I spend 1.5 hours just making it to the Institute. And then after the lecture, say it's 8:30 p.m. in the evening, and then you have to move to your home, and you spend another 1.5 hours. So basically, you've spent a total of 3 hours to just do a lecture of 2 hours. It was indeed taxing. Nowadays, you don't have to rush to one central place, and you can be able, I alongside my other trainers, are able to deliver these lectures from whichever point, for as long as we have that kind of connectivity. So this is feeding into efficiency in terms of how much we can achieve within the limited time available for us to achieve. Being a banker myself with Housing Finance Bank, there's a lot to do on that side. And therefore, I want to optimize my time allocation between what I do at the workplace, which is my day-to-day job at Housing Finance Bank as head of strategy, but also at the Institute where I come to share knowledge with bankers and I'm able to interact with people from different financial institutions. I'm able to pick insights about what the industry is, where the industry is going and what is trending. And so I have to optimize my time. And suddenly, as a family man, I have to spare time to be at home and also interact with the young ones and mentor. Doreen talked about mentorship at the workplace. We also do mentorship, not just at the institute, but also in our various families where we come from. And suddenly, as a trainer and as a student, you have these obligations, challenging obligations. Some students are actually running 2 to 3 jobs to be able to survive and also make it in terms of paying tuition for the courses here at the institute. So e-learning comes in as kind of a gateway that can help us achieve a lot of competencies and skills, as Mr. Michael talked about, Michael Mugabe alluded to, in terms of how can you learn, how can you gain this professionalism while still at the workplace that you keep running. So e-learning offers us this flexibility, time savings, and also efficiency that I see. In terms of challenges that I've seen with e-learning, I've seen that there's quite limited interactions. A couple of weeks ago, I was conducting an e-learning class, and I had friends from Lira and Arua, and some were from Jinja, and then also Kampala here. And I realized that they felt that they're not connected in a way. They felt that they are just speaking online. It's like a radio, a television set, or a computer somewhere. And they needed to get into the feeling that they are actually in class. And it was after a couple of days that they really learned that, okay, when I go for an e-learning lecture, then I have to be there with a pen, with a paper, or with my notebook. And it's like, I'm real studying. This is the new normal. Mr. Kalifungwa alluded to the new normal. This is the new normal of how we can do the things of e-learning. And so it becomes something that is taking a bit of time. The appreciation is taking a bit of time. And for some students, you talk to them and they're like, okay, I'll get there, but is it real learning? Can we really learn? And after the first lecture, they're like, okay, I think this is the way to go. Because I was seated at my desk, workplace, I'd closed my books, and I was able to start learning without wasting that much time in jam. And just like we have learned now to conclude deals without shaking hands, traditionally a deal would be concluded by a handshake. Under the standard operating procedures, we have to conclude these deals without shaking hands or expressing affection without really hugging. This is a new normal, and this is the new way of learning. To me, it also gives me an opportunity to enroll for some courses that I considered out of reach because I did not have that time to allocate. I didn't have that time, for example, to run to a lecture after leaving my job. And also after doing a few lectures on my side, and therefore I needed to be able to I can now enroll on such to be able to run these courses. I'm also seeing that, and this is a challenge for the education service providers, we'll be in position to get these courses. I assume that, to Ms. Goretti, that given that there are deficiencies in terms of delivery of these lectures, given that we can actually study without really going to class, I'm seeing that the cost of providing the services should go down because everybody is talking about cost management under e-learning. So I'm excited. I'm looking forward to seeing some new cost structures, not just from the Institute of Banking and Financial Services, but also from other institutional service providers, cutting out that cost of travel, for example, for the facilitators, and then the student getting the benefit of this kind of arrangement in e-learning. I'm looking forward to that as a challenge to the education service providers across the country and for the benefit of the bankers in the room that are tuning in now and the banking fraternity in the country. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your kind attention. That's my sharing. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Peter. Very good from your speaking from the heart as a trainer and also a person who's been with the Institute and experienced on that. And you've brought in the issue of numbers. And I would like to ask Mr. Kalibungo at this point, because we are hearing the numbers, and I'm looking at the budgeting process. By the time the Black Swan came in, we had already done our budgets, our numbers. And I'm just wondering, just from a perspective as a representative of our seniors and our heads, we'd like to hear, because there's all this drive in terms of supporting us. We had Doreen talking about we need to give the staff internet connectivity. We need to support them in setting themselves up, probably do some other training, soft skills and all that. What impact has this had, or have you heard from your colleagues or from your own personal perspective in terms of the budget? Have you had to scale down your budgets? Have you had to, has there been a spike? Has there an increase on the numbers? Because again, we know this will drive a challenge to the financial services sector because we are also there to make money. So just some words from you, Mr. Kalifungwa, on that aspect.
Yeah, thanks very much, Rita. There we are, the technology challenges, getting used to unmuting, switching off things, right? Yeah. But nevertheless, thanks for the question. So ideally, as you know, when you go through a budgeting process, there are a number of assumptions that you make regarding, say, the economy from a growth perspective, where the business has come from, what is happening in the environment, opportunities that you foresee. So there are internal factors that you take into account, looking at maybe your historical perspective and where your strategy is taking you to. The external factors as well. And like any other organization, you may have seen recently in the media, a number of Pan-African banks on the continent have been showing a reduction, say, in profitability that has been impacted mostly, say, by an increase in the expected credit losses that businesses expect to see or incur in the remaining part of the year. So from a budgeting perspective, really, I think what this event has triggered was for us to all sit down, I would imagine, across industry players. Forecasting or revised forecasting is something, a process that we, all follow. And as a consequence of the significant nature of these external shocks that arose or from the unforeseen eventuality, there has been need to revise your forecasts in terms of where you expect to end from a revenue perspective, what sort of credit losses you anticipate, what sort of costs you expect to incur in line with the environment. So from a forecasting perspective, it has meant that it has been necessary to revise your forecasts. Where you see opportunities, you revise them upwards. Where you see challenges or threats, you revise them downwards. But I think as in all environments, the first half of 2020 has seen a number of banks and other institutions that just post a reduction in profitability, because the slowdown that we had in the second quarter of the year is something that impacted all industries. So from a budgeting perspective, it has been necessary to revise forecasts and look for opportunities that can counter all the threats that we are seeing in the environment. From a cost perspective, a training perspective, in the case of ourselves as APSA, there has been no need to scale down on the training, as it were, because I think there is that realization that we need to continue to invest in the skills development of our colleagues. We need to invest in platforms that are enabling us to operate in this environment. So if I were to link in the sort of responses that we've undertaken, I think it has been to say, how can we enhance usability of the platforms? Fortunate for us, we were ahead of the curve. We embarked on projects as part of our overall separation from our parent company, our former parent company, PLC, whereby all these aspects to do with training, personal development, have all been consolidated onto a system. So this has provided us with an opportunity to accelerate the adoption and the usage of digital platforms from a training perspective, But from a budget perspective, as I indicated, we've had to do revised forecasts, but training is not a line that we have cut down on as a consequence. And we still remain committed to ensuring that we continue to develop and invest in our people. I hope that provides some context, Rita.
Yes, it does, and a lot of comfort from concern from our members, our staff, because definitely I think that's good comfort to know that at least the training line is still required and is still important to our seniors. So I think the human capital team that's listening in must be feeling comfortable with that response. I want to ask one more question to each of the participants before I open up to the Q&A, which is beginning to pick up in the interest of time. And I'll go back to Doreen. Doreen, you talked about partnerships with different institutions and where you're validating your information. And I don't think I heard you mention UIBFS. UIBFS is our key a partner for training in the country. So I just wanted to hear your thoughts in terms of what thoughts you have about UIBFS being a strategic partner. How can we go about validating and using it as a platform to validate some of this training that we are doing so that then the partnership can continue and we leverage on each other, because the platform is there, it is to support the bankers. And when we are doing our trainings, how would you like it? And these are your thoughts in terms of, especially with the institute as it's listening in, what advice would you give in terms of areas of recommendation, and so that you would look at them also as a strategic partner and one of the institutions that you can use to validate some of your trainings, maybe the curriculum, and any thoughts that you have as takeaways for the institute.
Thanks, Rita. I would say that absolutely UIBFS becomes quite strategic in the sense that we are not just talking about banks individually. I think we are talking about the financial industry in Uganda. And I imagine every financial institution is really trying to improve the lives of Ugandans, right? Improve on our economy. So every time we train someone, we are essentially creating better leaders, right, within the country. So UIBFS has the opportunity, because then they have, as an institution, the integration points and collaboration from all the other banks. So in terms of what that partnership would look like, I think the different banks, we may have different challenges, but I find that a lot of them will be quite similar. So if we can leverage off of our learnings and thought process in terms of what we want to solve for as banks. If we brought all of that thinking together, UIBFS then becomes the organization that brings all of that thinking, and then we are able to co-create. I find that these off-the-shelf solutions may not necessarily be enough. So there's an opportunity to co-create in terms of how do you create content that's more real, given what we're experiencing as a country or as a financial industry? And then how do you also make sure that that content is future-focused and future-ready? So we keep talking about future skills. We're talking about how quickly the customer demands are changing, how quickly digitization is disrupting the financial industry. So this provides a great opportunity for us to collaborate. I think each and every one of us, in terms of the people that we work with, would benefit from this kind of initiative. It also allows us to certify. You know how you go through an institution and you go speak to someone else and you say, look, I went to UIBFS and this was my certification. I think it will provide a certain legitimacy to what you have been learning. And I think, speaking for myself, it would be a great opportunity to just share learnings and share things that we're trying to solve for in terms of how quickly we accelerate. There may be things that I'm doing in Stanbic Bank, and I may have struggled, right, because we started from scratch or whatever that case may be. I don't think every other financial institution should have to struggle to solve for the same thing. So if I go through the pains, how do I share that? So the next person doesn't have to go through the same pain, but can pick lessons and apply that in their own environment. And I believe that UIBFS then becomes that integrator that can put all of that together and deliver meaningful learning and content across the financial industry. Thanks, Vika.
Thank you, Doreen. That's very good information for the Institute, definitely, and as part of their strategy in terms of promoting training in the industry. I'm sure they're all ears trying to see what we can pick up from that. And Peter, you are a trainer at the Institute. You have heard what the banks are looking at. You are also a banker, and you have done both in-house training and external training within the institution. Just from your experience and from your, in terms of awareness, where you have done trainings in-house as part of your employer, and also the ones that are done at the institute as an external trainer, what are your thoughts? What takeaways would you kind of, and you have talked, apart from now the budget, we've heard about the numbers, you're advocating for reduced costs. However, when it comes to internal training and as well as training at the external trainer, what is your experience? What is your takeaway? What advice would you give, especially now that we are on an e-platform? What would you, what are your thoughts around this space?
Thank you, Rita. I've certainly gone through a number of trainings myself as a trainee at the bank and also here at the Institute. Initially face-to-face, now we're getting into e-learning. Indeed, at the bank, we have an e-learning platform that enables us to keep learning. It's a routine. It's a continuous process that we have to embrace. The experience that we've had, particularly if I refer back to the bank, is that initially there was a bit of resistance because of the perks that would ordinarily come with the face-to-face, the advantages of face-to-face, meaning you have a facilitator there, you have a day off just to focus on this particular session. And then you can even block the work-related assignments. If it's abroad, then you're able to experience differently because you're flying out to attend this course. And so when you replace that with e-learning, where you just have to sit at your workstation and then get the lecturer or a course facilitator interact with you, then for some people, that kind of...
Your link is frozen.
I wasn't very sorry. I think you had lost me for a moment. That change,
yes, we had
that kind of changeover wasn't very easy, but consistent highlighting of the advantages of e-learning, when people experience it for the first time and it's real life, it's really exemplifying the learning. That should be the way it should be. People get to appreciate it and they begin to embrace it. Initially, from my workplace, we had utilization rates of our e-learning platform below 20%. But now they've gone over 60%. Individuals are eager to pick up the courses that come on e-learning platform. So I see that coming through across the entire banking fraternity. Doreen has also spoken about it from Stanbic. And I see many banks appreciating this and also beginning to run. Our colleagues at NSSF have had their story. They embraced this about 3-4 years ago, and the entire industry is going to pick up on e-learning. And so the institutes would play a critical role, particularly where banking and finance training is, to popularize e-learning first, but also getting the core, which is instilling professional knowledge for the bankers. I see this being the future of our industry and the way we're going to be learning. Thank you. Thank you, Rita.
Thank you, Peter. That's very interesting from both your own personal experience and as well as where you're seeing the institute going. I'd like to go back to Mr. Kalifungwa and kind of ask again from an industry perspective, generally from the industry. I know, and I've been in the bank for some time, you've had my experience, there's been a lot of poaching in this industry. Everybody wants to take everyone's trained person. And I'm looking at this opportunity whereby it's e-learning, where we can all learn from the same page and maybe have a lot of people training. And just to hear your thoughts from an industry leader, what do you look at in terms of if we were to work with the Institute and kind of create certain standards and expectations? You've talked about key areas like credit, like soft skills, whereby everybody needs the same. And at the end of the day, our clients are multi-banked. They bank with everywhere. It would be nice for client to have the same experience bank to bank. And maybe you differentiate yourselves in terms of pricing and things like that. I'm looking at it as it might even have economies of scale if we are all using one lecturer to train instead of everybody aligning their own program. We've had personalized training with the Institute. And so where would you look at this kind of a thought process whereby if we partnered, coming off from where Doreen spoke in terms of sharing experiences, where Peter is also speaking in terms of using an e-learning platform. But from a bank perspective, in terms of, again, we are looking at cost management and value add and improving the industry, the regulation is the same. When you look at the regulation on, say, KYC, we all require to have the same KYC as per the ML platform. When the regulator comes to investigate, they'll give us the same findings. So I think there might be some areas where we might have a benefit. And we wanted to hear your thoughts in terms of and what advice you would give the Institute in terms of how would we partner to be able to get into this kind of a process. Your thoughts in this one, kind of as takeaways to the Institute.
Thanks very much, Rita. And a very interesting question. And I think off the top of my head, some of the conversations that we have as a leadership team, for instance, if I were to take the world of, say, operations, when you look at operations in a bank, it is a very broad segment or department of your bank. I think it's one of the largest, I think, in most of the banks that operate in the sector. And it has got various elements. I mean, operations is an area where you deal with payments, you deal with systems, you deal with fraud and several other aspects that you deal with. And one of the conversations, for instance, that I've had with my co is to say, what thoughts do you have around having, say, a core center of excellence in terms of training within the market? And for me, just using that as an example, because when you look at a chief operating officer role in a bank, it's not a role that you go to school to do where you're saying, I'm going to be a qualified chief operating officer. It is a role that you gain as a consequence of having multiple experience across jurisdictions and the like. So you're absolutely right. What this does provide is a case for the Institute to collaborate with the banking fraternity and identify what are the key skills gaps that are required within the banking sector. What are the future skills that are required to equip bankers with? What are the pain points in the sector? Things like cyber fraud, financial crime, credit analytics, and the like. Is there a way of creating a curriculum that speaks specifically to the needs that are arising in the sector? Most of the times, I think one of the things you possibly need to consider as a challenge, I think recently there was in the media of, Google coming up with, their own forms of degrees, a degree that you can qualify within 6 months. So the aspect of time, the aspect of costs are things that are becoming quite critical when it comes to learning developments. So the challenge I'll throw to the Institute is to say, how can you rethink the delivery in terms of learning? How can we be more skills-based and skills that are relevant to driving the industry and are responding to trends or challenges that are occurring in the industry? So I'll submit that, yes, there is a great opportunity. I guess we also all need to put our heads together against I don't know if you call it the human capital value chain, if I may call it that, human capital value chain, and look at the various elements in the value chain, the employers, the employees, the environment, and the Institute. Once we look at the elements or those four elements relating to the human capital value chain, then we should have a solution coming through from the Institute that responds to the needs of the bankers, the rare skills in the market, and possibly that can be one of the solutions to this aspect of skills being poached between one bank or another. But as I say again, when it comes to personal development, individuals have got different aspirations at any point in time. But what this intervention from the Institute will do is to ensure that the skills base is capacitated equally across the industry, and the growth or differentiation will be dependent on the individuals themselves in terms of how far they want to, you know, push their learning envelope or their capability envelope going forward. So that would be my view to that, Rita.
Thank you very much, Mumba. I think you've really spoken to it, and I'm sure it represents the thoughts of the other CEOs. I would like now to take the opportunity to get some questions in the Q&A platform so that then we can respond to our participants. There have been quite a number. We had over 150 participants listening in, which is a great attendance. I also want to recognize Mr. Anthony Mulindwa, the former CEO of the Institute, who's also joined in. Thank you for keeping a good relationship with the Institute. So now, the questions, some of them may be general and anyone can pick it up. Some are very specific to the different panelists and presenters. So let's see. We have one question which I think we can answer. Will Mr. Mumba be in a position to share his link? Yes, his pack, his slide pack. Yes, the Institute will share that. Please make sure you register your email and contacts in the Institute. Again, the other one is, and the next one is also asking, it was a wonderful one. We need a copy of that presentation. The next question is to Doreen. Doreen, have you been able to implement the instructor-led e-learning model? If you have, please share with us some insights. I think I'll read quite a few so that then you can answer them in the interest of time. The next one is also to Doreen, and it was from, the first one was from Solomon Liyombo. Next one is Sylvia Maloney asking, Doreen, what are some of the specific things you have done to build self-led learning behavior? Andrew Obara is saying, great presentation, Mumba and panelists, much appreciated. Just a few questions. And then the questions are, you rightly mentioned credit analytics as a key. I think this is to Mumba. You rightly mentioned credit analytics as a key banking skill. What do the high rising credit disbursements targets in many banks do to credit analysis? Embracing e-learning has something to do with HR issues of mindset. In many of our banks, HR is not even at the ExCo where policy issues are being discussed. Is this healthy? And then the next one is also to, I think I'll say this one, then we can answer those. Dear all, thanks for this discussion. My question is to the MD at ABSA and Doreen. I realize that your two institutions have one of the biggest footsteps in the banking industry. This implies, in terms of staff, your numbers are material. However, in terms of professional training, your staff are very few, especially at the Institute. So I'll pause at that point and have Doreen and Mumba answer those two. Then we can move on to the next set. Doreen will start first and then Mr. Mumba will pick up.
All right. Thanks, Rita. I'll start with the first one around instructor-led program. Yes, we have launched that. We've already started doing that type of learning in terms of delivery. Some of the tips or things that we've done to allow us make it meaningful. One is that for every program that's going to be instructor-led but online, we have time with the teams. So prior to the program actually commencing, we have a session with the team and the instructor. And that session is just to prepare the team in terms of what we're going to be learning, how will it be delivered, if there is pre-work, this is where it's going to be. So, you know, the logistics of it, so people have time to kind of think about or paint the picture in terms of the flow and then prepare for the actual commencement of the program. The other one that we've done really, one of the other tips is keep the classes relatively small. Online, it's easy to assume that because it's online, then we'll have, if it's a virtual program, we'll have as many people as we like. It's important to allow for that interaction. and for interaction and meaningful interaction to happen, that class should not be too big. So we've tried to keep our classes to a maximum of 30. This allows for conversations, Q&As to happen much more easily than if you have a really, really large class. We are also utilizing breakaway sessions. So the programs happen virtually, but it's really important to have those breakaway sessions to allow people to interact with each other. And so that provides some kind of connection, even though the program is running virtually. What we've also included in there are projects. So it's really important to us to make sure that the learning lands. So when we start the program, even in terms of preparation, we link that to the goal. What are we solving for with this program? And we clarify that prior to the program actually starting. So towards the end, everyone knows there's going to be either homework or a project that needs to be implemented to actually check application of the learning. And a lot of our instructor-led programs now have an extension of mentorship or coaching, depending on the program. And this is really to allow for additional support to the learners once the official program has ended and they're practicing. So you keep learning or mentoring and coaching them to really check that they've really understood and they're applying that and the shifts required in the business are happening. In terms of delivery as well, taking breaks. I think it's easy to start a session and do the whole day and then people are feeling like, man, we're exhausted. So adult learning is not easy. So we allow for breaks in between, a leg stretch, something to just get people away from the classroom before they can return and commence. So breaks are very regular as well. Also in terms of our content, we make very good use of videos. So we don't want it to just be talking. So we try different things, videos, those breakaway sessions to break the monotony of just looking and watching someone do or discuss what's being learned. So those are just some of the tips that we have used and they're working out well so far. In terms of the second question, building self-led learning, some of the specific things that we have done. First and foremost, linking it to a personal goal. Learning is amazing, but I won't really think it's important if it's not addressing something that's meaningful to me, right? So it's got to be very personal and close to my heart. So we are bringing that back to what's your career journey, you know? What are you trying to learn? Where are you trying to go? That PDP, that personal development plan, what does it have? So we are linking it back to what's meaningful to people. So the conversations that we are having to say, look, the organization may not guarantee you a job, right, for the next 10 years. However, we can guarantee you an opportunity to reinvent yourself as the ways of work are changing. So that's allowing people to connect to the purpose. So purpose becomes really, really, really useful to just get people to say, okay, I'm going to do this and I'm doing it for myself. I'm not doing it for Stanbic Bank. The other thing that we have utilized is team learning. We find that learning in teams makes it more collaborative and exciting. And then after that, what you've seen is that teams who have embraced the team learning moment, the individuals in those teams then quickly get into the learning platforms. I think it triggers something in people's minds when they learn as a team, because then individually they start to explore what's happening on the learning platforms. We've agreed skills per team. Again, there's so much information, so it's really important to focus people so they don't feel overwhelmed. So we've agreed skills for teams, and then we start there to say, this will show you what the learning pathway looks like. Click here. Just click, and it leads you to where that content is. I think this is helping people to just gradually get into the space, but they're not feeling completely overwhelmed. Reporting has become very, very, very critical for us. People will focus on what you're tracking. So we're doing weekly statistics in terms of what are people learning, you know, what future skills are people learning, who is learning the most, which teams are lagging behind. And those reports are allowing us to now engage the teams that may be struggling to understand what's the challenge, how do we walk this journey with you. For some of the programs, there's certifications. We are Ugandans. We love to have certificates. So I think it's important. It's like a sense of achievement. So for some programs, there are certificates. We recently got onto Salesforce, which is Trailhead. It gives badges. So each stage of completion for a program, you get a badge, and each badge is bigger than the other. So that's allowing for some real healthy competition among the teams. Of course, now we're also looking into recognition. Again, when you're starting a new journey and you're trying to create a behavior shift or culture, it's important to recognize the behaviors that are demonstrating, or people who are demonstrating the right behavior. So that recognition also has come in handy. So in terms of the third question, which was addressed to myself and Mr. Kalifumwa around having fewer people at UIBFS, look, I think this is a great opportunity for all of us. And in terms of the discussion we're having now to say, how do we collaborate more? And what should the Institute be putting out in terms of content? If we can work together and start to put out content that's relevant to what the financial industry is trying to address and is directly addressing the future skills that we must have within the financial industry, then I guarantee that we'll start to have more participation from Stanbic as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Doreen. And I think now Mr. Kalifunga would like to take his set of questions. They're kind of like three in one.
Yeah, so what I'll do is I'll start with the last one that Doreen spoke to. And I think the response to that is similar, really. It's all about how we can collaborate better with the Institute in terms of them providing, you know, relevant programs that are responding to the challenges in the environment and that fitting with the circumstances of the individual learners from a, you know, mandatory learning perspective, a vocational learning perspective, as it were, but it all depends on how the Institute responds from that perspective. So the first question from Fem Bernard was around rising credit and how, you know, credit analytics impacts that. So if I got that question correctly, ideally, when you look at, expected credit losses, there are assumptions or models that you use to determine what sort of credit losses you will undertake. And essentially, the input to these models is the historical behavior of the particular loan products over a certain period of time. And what I also do know is that there are standards that have been developed, accounting standards that have been developed, that determine the way you compute expected credit losses, and that will be a function of your book. As your book grows, there will be a certain component that you need to reserve or create provisions for that is general in nature. And without getting too technical in terms of how credit losses are classified, that's the simple analogy will be that as your book arises, the credit losses or provisions that you take will be in two forms. There will be an element that is general that you take into account by your, based on the historical knowledge from your credit analytics and your credit history of performance of products in particular sectors, in particular portfolios, and the like. So as your credit disbursements increase, that element of the provisions for expected credit losses needs to be taken into account. And of course, in the event that as you increase your lending appetite to certain sectors and there is specific loss events that occur, then there'll be a corresponding increase in the credit losses that you absorb. So those are the two main elements to consider in that. And what credit analytics does do is provide you with that ability, exactly that ability, the ability to predict the impact of any expected future credit losses as a consequence of your understanding of the portfolio from its past behavior and any external factors such as macroeconomic factors that impact your prediction of future credit losses. I think that is around the first question. The second question, human capital positions or HR or people director roles are critical. I couldn't agree with you more. I think human capital is at the core of the very business that we do. And in the event that organizations have the capacity to absorb those roles at a senior executive level, it is imperative that you have your people function or HR function director sitting as part of EXCO so that they can help in shaping the strategic direction of the institution from a capability perspective and skills development perspective. So I agree with yourself there, and I think it is a challenge that you know, put out there to those institutions that have capacity to absorb such roles at an exco position, but totally aligned with your point of view there.
Thank you, Mumba. That's a very good response, and training on credit. We've picked quite a few tips on that one. And I think I'll take our last set of questions in the interest of time. I think we are beginning to run a bit out of time. And the next one comes from Nicholas Nabende, who's saying, what plan do you have to improve on this? It's not very clear, and I think it may be quite difficult. It does, and it is not specific to anyone. Then again, he says, thanks. I think that was thanks to his previous question. And let's see the next ones. Jennifer Kawa is asking, what methodologies are you using to evaluate the outcomes of e-learning and its contribution to the growth of the banking industry? Probably this is to Doreen, I think I would think of as a person. And then the next one from Oyet Okwera, how are banks coping with the new direction of e-services given the low appreciation of internet-based banking by clients? I think I'll give this one to Mumba. Then the next one, I think probably Goretti might have to take it up in her wrap-up marks. It says the UIBFS was in the process of introducing a master's degree in agribusiness management. When is it expected to start at the institute? And then there's one I picked up in the chat which says, what quick wins do you start with to help staff to adapt to e-learning, sudden shift due to lockdown? I'll give this to Peter, as he's been saved a lot of the questions. So Mr. Kalifua, maybe you take the one that is yours, and then Peter, and then Doreen last.
Okay, so mine is around the new direction of e-services given the low internet use. Look, I think it's a challenge that has befallen us. And what I can say, I think based on the statistics for my own bank, and also from the industry perspective, you will note that this year, in comparison, when you look at the you know, the transactions that are conducted on various platforms, majority of those relating to individuals and corporates are now being done electronically. Yes, the internet penetration levels can be said to be a challenge, but I think Uganda has in excess of 10 million internet users. The total bank population, I think we are looking at about 1.6 million clients or so, if my memory serves me right. So to the extent that the number of banked customers are lower than the number of internet users, I do believe that I think Uganda has one of the most high internet penetration levels. If we take it a notch further and look at, say, mobile device users, there are in excess of 20 million users of mobile devices. So I do believe that there is a great opportunity to continue to migrate people onto these mobile devices. And banks such as mine have come up with interventions such as reverse billing for data, such that all these mobile users or people who have access to mobile phones can be able to access our internet services on what we call a reverse billing mode. So from my perspective, I think a great opportunity does arise. And based on the statistics that we've been able to see, we've seen a huge migration of our clients in the various business segments onto the online platforms. So yes, much as penetration may not be at 100%, I do believe that we are well positioned to continue to drive this change in behavior. And this is being done through consistent client engagements and just having conversations in terms of e-learning or tele conversations with our clients as we onboard them and just showcase the capabilities and efficiencies that come with working online other than going to physical branches. So that would be my submission in that regard. Thanks.
Thank you. Peter, would you respond to the other one very quickly, and then Doreen can respond to her last one before we hand over to the Institute.
Thank you, Rita. On the quick wins that we can start with to help staff adapt to e-learning, sudden shift due to lockdown, I think one thing that we can do is awareness quickly. We enhance people's knowledge about the existence of e-learning courses and the kind of skills that they can get online. That is through such engagements like what we are running now, but also for the employers, different banking institutions to encourage their staff to take on these courses. Support will be important. Say if a member of staff is interested in a course, you may allow them work beyond the hours that they are supposed to stay in an institution, give them a room to be able to take on some courses that they want to do, maybe a couple of hours a day, could support them to do the courses that they need to do. That's from the employer support. But also finally, learning is an individual initiative. For individuals out there that are looking at learning, it takes commitment, personal commitment, to be able to do and complete a course. So I'll encourage each and every individual who is looking at getting this done to have that drive to take on an e-course. Thank you very much.
Hey, thank you, Peter. Doreen, very quickly, I see two hands in the audience, but if you can respond quickly to that one, so we give our two speakers a chance to ask, and then we can wrap up after that.
All right, thank you, Rita. My question is, I think, on checking impact of the methodologies of e-learning. What I can share is for each learning, it has got to be linked to a goal. We don't want to learn just for the sake of learning. So what are you solving for right from the beginning before any learning interventions? What goal are you trying to achieve? What challenge are you trying to solve for? And it has to be clear in terms of what would success look like. So when the learning happens, those conversations, first of all, need to have happened prior to the program starting, and the candidate is very clear on what it is they need to be solving for. Then once the program has ended, then it's important to agree to a review period. How much time do you need to allocate or put aside for people to apply the learning? Once that period has been agreed, then you do a review. And that review needs to link back to the goal. What were you solving for? In terms of success, are you seeing that success? If yes, well and good. If not, what's missing? It could be that maybe we did not plan the right learning intervention, but it could be that people are not fully applying the learning. But what's really, really critical for me is to decentralize this. This work cannot just sit within human capital or within learning and development. The line manager is very, very, very critical to the transformation of an individual, to transformative learning, because the line manager sees this person, they sit with them, they talk with them every single day. So when the learning happens, they have to be part of the journey to mentor or to coach, to guide, to make sure that people are actually applying that learning. So what then that means is that every time we start a program, the line managers are aware of the program and they are aware of what the people are learning. And if they're going to be used as mentors or coaches, we do a quick upskilling for them as well in terms of clarifying the areas they need to look out for as people apply the learning post the program. Thanks, Rita.
Thank you, Doreen. And I have two hands in the audience. That is Herman Karugaba and Henry Anthony. If you can ask your questions concurrently so that we can respond to them, and then we can wrap up. Please unmute yourself and speak. We'll start with Henry Anthony and then Herman. Herman, speak. You're unmuted. Hello, Herman, can you speak? Maybe unmute Henry, so maybe they've given up, I don't know. Okay, I think probably they have given up, I don't see them speaking, but I want to thank so much our presenters today, Mr. Mumba Kalifungwa. Thank you so much for that keynote speech. I think it was really, really very well articulated, and it has generated a lot of excitement. Doreen, sharing your experience. You've just come in, but wow, it's really, really exciting to listen to you. There's so much passion, and we really love that. And Peter, of course, you shared a lot. You've been on both sides of the platform, so it was quite interesting to listen from you. And we are sure that with this kind of talk and thought process, there's going to be a lot of future for the banks and Institute. Thank you once again, Mr. Mumba, for representing our chief executives. That was really, really good. And welcome once again to Uganda. I'm sure you're really going to enjoy yourself. This is the Pearl of Africa. You can't be in a better place in Africa than Uganda.
Thank you very much, Rita. And thank you for your moderation. Yes. I think you've moderated us very well. And thank you to my other participants, Peter and Doreen, for working with me.
Okay. So I'd like to hand over to the Chief Executive, Mrs. Goretti Masade, to give us her remarks as we wind up. And we thank you for hosting us. We've enjoyed ourselves. Thank you.
Well, what can I say? Thank you very much, Rita, for such a wonderful job done. And I would like to say a special thank you to Mumba for an amazing keynote, and of course, Doreen and Peter for very wonderful insights. Before I go ahead, I would first of all want to tell everybody to stay around. We have got a very special offer that we shall give you at the end of this presentation. But also to ask Richard, we had a question first of all on agribusiness before I react to a number of the things that have been talked about. So I'd like to ask our registrar, Richard, please come on and answer the question on the Masters for Agribusiness.
Thank you very much.
Richard, we don't hear you.
Thank you very much. I hope I'm loud enough now.
Yes, you are.
I want to take this opportunity to thank the panelists and the presentation that has taken place. I think there's a question on when do we expect to start the Master of Agribusiness Management. I think, as you are all aware, the Institute is not yet a degree awarding body. So for all the postgraduate programs that we run at the Institute, we normally offer them through collaboration with chartered universities. And in this case, the Master of Agribusiness Management, our intention is to offer it with Mountains of the Moon University, a chartered and now a public university. And this process starts with seeking affiliation from National Council for Higher Education to run this program. We had anticipated that this program will roll off in September of this year, and started way back in February to seek and kickstart off the process of getting this affiliation. Unfortunately, because of the COVID-related challenges, the affiliating university, that is Mountain of the Moon University, was expected around May and to come and make inspection of our facilities before they can give a blessing to proceed with affiliation. And this has not taken place. We're still engaging with the university to complete the process, but otherwise at the Institute, we are ready to start off this program as soon as the necessary protocols have been done and we have received the blessing from the National Council for Education. Then we'll start it as soon as that process is complete. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Richard. I think that's very clear to our listeners. And at this point, of course, we are believing. We have done a lot of work. We're doing a lot of work already with National Council for Higher Education and continuing to engage with our partners. We believe that that will come through very soon. Now, I would like to comment and react on a number of things that have been raised, because there have been a call on the Institute to become more relevant and to be responsive to some of the things that have been shared. I want to tell you that recently we appointed a Senate, again in response to the needs of the National Council for Higher Education, And while interacting with the Senate, we did identify that perhaps we need to do a little bit more or a lot more in terms of sharing what the Institute is doing. And this is an opportunity to tell you how we are responding to some of the things that have been identified or brought up. I want to start off, of course, on Mumba's presentation, where he spoke about professionalism being long and intense academic preparation. And I want to say that, true, we are having a lot of training, which is a very good thing in the industry. Most of the training centers that we have, like in the different banks, are doing a lot of training. And it is intense, yes, but it's short-term training, a two-day training, a three-day training, to get you to where you need to be. But now when we talk about professional training, and allow me to share, that is where also the Institute coming. As an Institute, we have seen a change in trends, where initially we had a lot of professional training, but it has now gone towards the short skill, short-term training, which is good for you to do your job. But then the professionalism that gives you end-to-end sight of what is happening that will drive you to excellence and to your CEO roles, to your board roles, that's where professional training comes in. And I want to share with you just a little bit about what we have done and what we have on offer. Let me start off here. This is where we are going. The basic banking program, very, very quickly, just giving you end to end. You can imagine the cost coverage. So we are thinking that everybody who comes on board in the industry, and as long as we embrace the membership structure that we have given you, 15,000 of us out there, if everybody becomes a member for as little as 150 or 200,000, then this course is given free to each person. For a month, they can be able, and online too, and for only 500,000, they can be able to understand end to end of the industry. This reduces your orientation costs at the bank, but also ensures that everybody has an opportunity to do it. Let's talk about banking for non-banking executives. I got into banking at a managerial level as a corporate communications manager. This would have been ideal for me to understand the end-to-end, a little bit of the end-to-end of the industry or of the business as I support the business. And then to appraisal of agribusiness. I wanted to talk about this in particular because yes, we don't have the masters yet, but we have this appraisal for agribusiness, and then we have agricultural value chain financing that can also be utilized. And then we have certified credit management, again, professional, 9 months that one can utilize. And then finally, we have the postgraduate diploma in agricultural risk management and finance. All relatively long-dated programs, but professional too for you to utilize. We've got the Master of Arts for Financial Services. This is the only master's in the country for financial services, and it's in partnership with Makerere University. So this is something also, and look at the prices. All the prices are relatively manageable. What we would like to work with is the human resource fraternity, management fraternity, or capital management, human capital management fraternity, is to allow the staff, if the staff can then commit or the human resource can commit, we can have a monthly payment structure just so that our people become professionalized. Now, this is the killer. This one here is what we are, is going to be our anchor as a professional institute, the Chartered Banker Program. We will have some very good news for you. The good news is that we've gone to National Council for, when we took it for National Council for Higher Education, to accredit it again, because all courses are accredited every 5 years. We were told, and it was new because we hadn't yet, it's a new program. We were asked to merge part of our old programs, one which is actually the Certified Professional Banker Program, and merge some of the content into the Chartered Banker Program that we've come with, and make it an equivalent of a degree. How good is that? When we get into banking, the requirement is just have a degree, any degree. And then you get there, and God help you, you may you may get into credit and that's the line you'll ever know. But perhaps there was something else that you could have done in terms of a career. So the Chartered Banker program now is going to be the same, valued the same as you value ACCA and stuff like that. So now we can have your children coming off from Essex and coming straight to the Institute. We can have all of you. And then the human capital management is now going to have a crop where they do not need not say any degree. You can now see this. And also we are going to have a number of you who are bankers be really interested in the profession as banking and not just as something you do. The Chartered Banker program is here. The beauty about the program is that it has three levels, 3 years. Every year is certificated. So the first year, you do quite a bit and you become a professional banker. The next year, an executive banker. That means you're rising in knowledge and skill and experience. And the last year, you become a chartered banker. And these will be our fellows. So members, and then finally fellows, of course, having distinguished yourself in practice after you've got the Chartered Banker. So friends, this is what we have for you. Now, let me speak also to the fact that we have had, there's a lot of online degrees. Yes, it's true. But I think recently you've also seen where somebody was challenging, it was Macquarie University for one of the posts, that they were challenging a master's degree because that particular university was not accredited in the US. Similarly, even here, that's why we are laboring to make sure we have affiliations with accreditation, but also getting accreditation from National Council for Education so that your certificate means something to you. Now, let me speak about the new technology, soft skills, compliance, computer skills. You'll be amazed that all these things are actually at the Institute, but perhaps you just didn't know before. Now, during the lockdown, we were busy. We were busy and came up with a number of things through partners. This particular one is through it's the Franklin Covey group that we are working with, and they've come up with a course, Thriving Through Uncertainty, that we are delivering with them, $250 US dollars per person, 6 sessions of 75 minutes each, developing emotional intelligence, very important. 8 sessions, 75 minutes each, $350. And then you have leading at the speed of trust in terms of times of uncertainty. Again, they've given us prices that are relatively cheaper than what you would get them if you went to them direct. Coaching and mentoring through uncertainty. All these are available for you. We've shared them in different perspectives, but when I hear Mumba come up and tell us, this is what we want. To an extent, we've been responsive. We just want you to know that this is available for you. Now, let me take you also to what we've been doing in terms of digital solutions. Now, digital solutions, this one we've done with the London Institute of Banking and Finance, and these are in development. So the moment we get to know what is priority, we start with that, because you know we are always in the kitchen, and sometimes it frustrates to be in the kitchen and the food is not eaten, or maybe they don't know it, or maybe in terms of prioritization. So we are coming to you to say, please choose what you like out of this. Now, this is London Institute of Finance. Now, digital retail bank, and it's at three levels, the awareness level, the middle level, and the executive level, so or strategic level. Digital banking awareness level for these ones, it will be $200 per participant. And of course, eventually, this is likely to come at £200 per participant, but this is likely to come down. And the cohort is necessary, the cohort of 30 participants. And this is where working as an industry comes in. Then, of course, we've got introduction to fintech. It's also an awareness level, a three-day program. Then we've got all of them at the same price. Innovation in banking and finance. Now, this is mid-level. Now you're getting to management. Then you've got emerging technologies in banking and finance, also at mid-level, a three-day program. And then alternative finance, again, mid-level. And finally, fintech leadership. Now this is at a strategic level. Digital transformation at a strategic level. And that's what we have for you. So I'm feeling that as an institute, we're sort of validated, that we are not seated. We are doing this for you, but we still realize that we need to come back to you to get to understand which of this is priority. We would like to have all these things done yesterday. And we are in talks that the development starts as soon as we are ready. Now I want to talk about compliance, ethics, and integrity. This, in partnership with the Institute of Social Securities, we are working, we've got an integrity workshop program. And this we are actually saying it's a facilitation, sort of facilitated program. We have agreed to have facilitators trained as soon as between this month and October. And then after that, we are able to do it for you. The other thing that we are doing is that we have agreed from the membership structure that you approved recently that for all the CPDs, continuous professional development points that we'll be looking for, 5 of them will be in integrity, ethics and integrity. So definitely we are going to address this very keenly. And then of course, there is the issue of regulatory compliance again. We are in partnership with an advocate. We've come up with an MOU with an advocate, has come up with an excellent program that we'll also share with you. So that is also available for you for the taking. And finally, let me talk about the costs going down. You may not know, but we are affiliated with a number of bodies. And for now, I would like to talk about the Global Banking Education Standards Board. We've also started having a series of webinars, and everybody's grappling with the same thing. How do we do e-learning? How do we serve our membership? How do we serve the industry? And what came out clearly for some of them, interestingly, is that the cost did not necessarily go down. For some of them, for the institute, for the trainers that come to the institute, for the students that come to the institute, it can be a challenge. I mean, it can be a reduction in cost. For the institute, surprisingly, but I'm glad that it's the trainer that proposed it. For the institute, surprisingly, the hourly rate for the trainers remains the same. In some cases, because of the internet challenges, we may have to have shadow lecturers. That if something happens to one, another one is there, which means instead of doing 1 hour or the same rate per whatever, you're actually doing double the rate. But where is the catch? The catch is in raising cohort numbers and having the partnership with the industry. Because once that happens, then we can have scale. And once we have scale, definitely the cost will come down. Even if we have 2 lecturers happening, trainers doing their thing at the same time, the fact that you have got the numbers then ensures that you are able to meet the costs. One of the things we are sure you don't want us to do is to actually have an institute that's loss making, because then it's not sustainable. We should be here to ensure that we are all alive and getting better, getting stronger. Let's have a complete school of banking and finance as we go on, and perhaps even at a later time, your contributions may have to come down. And so I would like to stop off by saying the offer that we talked about, our cohort, that we have a cohort for the Chartered Banker program, which is now equivalent to a degree, for the Certified Credit Management, for the postgraduate degree in postgraduate diploma in agricultural risk management and finance. For all these things, we have a cohort that is starting on the 14th of September. And only for the people on the call, the board has approved that in case you are interested, we will give you a 7% discount. Expression of interest should be between now and Friday. We have your emails. And remember, again, we are working with the human capital management to ensure that at least you're able to do, our policy says 50% payment on enrollment, and within a month you pay the rest. But because of this collaboration that we are looking for, we would like to say it will be possible for you with commitment to do a monthly payment, as long as the commitment from your departments is there. Lastly, 2 interesting things. The membership restructure and the new membership structure, we are going to launch it in October, and we've come up with something exciting, what we are calling the Banking and Finance Awareness Week. This week is going to be one where you get to understand where you want to take your career. So we will have exposure to what it is, a number of talks during the week, but we also have a mandate for inclusion. So we are going to ask you to participate in ways, different ways. We are fine polishing up the concept. We will have insurance, we will have banking, we will have fintechs, we'll have all these people displaying. It will be virtual, so we'll have to have a portal for you to go to, but we also want you to take it up in the banking halls. We also want to make sure that the Wananchi down understand. We also have a product that we may suggest to you to ensure that everybody in this country reacts better than they have reacted before in times of something like COVID. So we are looking at ways we can have both inclusion and professionalism as our mandate is. And that is the last that I will say, but I would like to wrap up by saying a very well-structured presentations on our needs and the challenges and the solutions from you, Mumba. We couldn't have asked for a better person to do this keynote for us. For Doreen, thank you for sharing all your learning methods and how you have been doing it practically. And that shows and tells us what we can improve also at the Institute, but also for the entire industry. Thank you very much for your passion for development. For Peter, for sharing your changing story, the story before and after e-learning, that was amazing. And of course, for Rita, for doing an awesome job of mining insights from our panelists. Friends, thank you very much. We are waiting for you at the Institute, not at the Institute, virtually anywhere. Please call, let's collaborate, and thank you very much. So with this, I guess, and of course, I want to thank my chair, Michael, for doing a good job in the beginning, starting us off. And last but not least, the staff at UIBFS. You've been amazing at organizing this webinar, the number of webinars we are going to have them, they'll be monthly. So thank you very much. And let's meet again. You expect your CPD certificates.